Can you talk a little bit about some best practices that project managers and agencies may want to follow as they're developing their schedules?
Sure. The schedule assessment guide describes 10 best practices, as I mentioned. The 10 best practices are mapped to what we call the four characteristics of a reliable schedule. And very often when you open up a published GAO report and we've conducted an audit on an agency or project schedule, you'll see that we've reported out on the four characteristics. And the details, these 10 best practices, are often relegated to a technical appendix. And that's for ease of readability issues and keeping the content of the report succinct. The four characteristics, as we call them, are that a schedule is comprehensive, that a schedule is well constructed, that it's credible, and that it's controlled. And as I mentioned, the 10 best practices map into those four characteristics. So for instance, the first characteristic of a reliable schedule is that it's comprehensive. And this encompasses the best practices of capturing all effort, resource loading the schedule, and establishing reasonable durations of activities. So very quickly, we mentioned earlier that we look for the integration of all activities necessary to complete the project. That's capturing all effort. Ensuring that resources are integrated into the schedule is another important concept of a comprehensive schedule. And finally, the durations, within reason, assuming that there may be, for instance, rolling wave planning going on in a project, we'll take a look at the length of, or the durations of the activities in the detail planning period. And a best practice is what, through our research, we've learned a best practice is keeping those durations manageable. And a rule of thumb is, for instance, keeping durations of activities less than the reporting period of the schedule. So for instance, if you report out on a current schedule every 2 weeks, the activities that you're reporting out on should be no longer than 2 weeks. Now these are general rules of thumbs, of course, but that's what we mean by manageable durations of activities. The second characteristic is that a schedule is well constructed. And that's made up of three best practices. Best practice 2, sequencing all activities. Best practice 6, establishing a valid critical path. And best practice 7, ensuring the reasonableness of float. And these three best practices go hand in hand, really, with the math of a schedule network. I mean, in essence, a schedule network is nothing more than a database that's linked together with mathematics calculating dates through the relationship of activities. And these three best practices, get to the heart of the math of the network. So ensuring, for instance, that activities are linked properly through successor and predecessor logic. Date constraints are minimized. Issues such as lags, these sorts of data anomalies, are minimized. And if they're used in the schedule network, we look for documentation and justification of their use. Best practice 6, again, part of well-constructed schedule, is that the critical path is valid, meaning that activities that appear critical in the schedule network truly are driving the key dates in the schedule. Very often, because of date logic anomalies, activities will appear as critical, but they truly have no effect on key milestones. That's part of our assessment. And finally, the reasonableness of total float. Because if you're familiar with how total float is calculated, it comes out of the logic of the network, and that's why these best practices are so integrally related to each other. For reasonableness of float, what we're looking for is that the float as calculated in the schedule truly represents the flexibility of the project. And if we see exorbitant amounts of total float, we'll look for justification. More often than not, exorbitant amounts of total float are due to issues with the logic between activities. The third characteristic of a reliable schedule we call credible, and that's made up of two best practices. One is best practice 8, schedule risk analysis. That, again, is establishing a confidence level of key dates given the probability of risk and uncertainty affecting the project. Best practice five is also part of credibility. That is horizontal and vertical traceability of the schedule. It's very jargony, but what that means is horizontal traceability means that we can trace the workflow of activities leading to key handoffs and key deliveries. Vertical traceability simply means that dates as you roll up summary schedules are matching each other. So for instance, one of the checks that we will do during an assessment of a schedule is ensure that dates that decision makers are seeing in their program briefings or that the Hill is seeing in those briefings match the dates being calculated in detail schedules. And finally, the fourth characteristic of a reliable schedule is that it's controlled, and that's made up of the final two best practices, best practice nine, keeping the schedule current and up to date with progress, and best practice 10, baselining the schedule. For best practice nine, we looked for how regularly the schedule is status, giving progress to date, whether or not there are any date anomalies such as actual starts in the future or planned dates in the past. Certain software programs allow you to keep those anomalies in your schedule, unfortunately, and those are our basic checks that we look for. Other issues such as out-of-sequence logic, so activities that are accomplished out of order as planned. And finally, best practice 10, which is part of controlled, is establishing a baseline schedule and comparing current progress of your current schedule to that baseline schedule, whether it be monthly or weekly or how often the schedule is updated. Best practice is to always be comparing current progress with the original plan.